Hey everybody, welcome back for another office hours. We're going to call this office hours after hours. So John, we do office hour sessions with our boot camps every single week for our personal training and our nutrition course. But guys, you send in so many amazing questions that John and I can't make it to all of them every time. So John, tell these guys a real quick rundown on why we are doing office hours after hours.
Yeah, so again, you know, when you guys ask us questions, it allows us to understand what you want to understand better or what you don't understand. So that way we're kind of addressing specifically what you need or what you need to learn. You know, we know a lot about the course and what you guys need to do in order to pass the course and be a good trainer. But again, you guys might have some questions that are very relevant to not just you, but to everyone in the course. And you guys are doing such a good job of getting all these questions to us. It wasn't the case back in the day, but now we're getting so many questions that we're racing through them during office hours and literally running out of time. And we still have plenty of questions to address. We don't want to leave them unaddressed. So here we are.
Yes. All right. So this will be our first inaugural episode. We have six questions that we did not get to last week, which is the week ending 4/19, April 19th, 2024. All right. So each week, if we have additional questions that we don't get to, we will be posting an episode just like this one here on our YouTube channel, Office Hours, After Hours, as quickly as we can on Monday or Tuesday of the following week. All right. So our first question, John, someone asked, this is from nutrition, by the way. All the six questions that we have are from the nutrition office hours from last week. What is the best way to approach or handle a client who opens up about having a previous or current eating disorder? What would you say for this one?
I would say address it directly. This is one of those things that's uncomfortable. And it's easy to dance around it, right? When there's an uncomfortable situation, it feels easy to avoid because it's uncomfortable, right? No one really likes uncomfortable situations. But as a professional, it is a big deal for us to know when we have to step in and be direct with, you know, addressing a situation, but then also in some cases, giving a client some helpful advice that can push them toward getting some help. Because at the end of the day, that's really what's needed is potentially some help. And it's help that's outside of the scope of what we do. We can recognize the issue, but it's not up to us to help fix it other than helping to point someone in a direction where they can seek help. And sometimes for our clients, you know, that's the thing they need to hear. They may have friends or family members who are also avoiding uncomfortable conversations. And what a service we can provide to someone if we can be that voice of reason. At the end of the day, when we get into this job, most of us say we want to help people. This is someone who, if they're opening up about having some issues with food, some potential eating disorder type things, that's someone who needs some help. So let's put ourselves in a position where we can help, and I would say address it directly.
Yeah, I would say directly, but also sensitively, you guys. Because like John says, this is a difficult topic, but we are not diagnosing people. We are not here to tell people that they have eating disorders. So if you feel like it's outside of your scope, or maybe this person has a preoccupation with food that's above and beyond your scope, you must refer them out. And if you don't know who to send them to, start with their physician or a licensed dietitian. That's a great place to send them, you guys. And then that medical professional can make a referral from there, usually to a psychologist or somebody else who can help them with the mental aspects of their relationship with food. So don't be afraid to refer out, but don't try and handle stuff on your own because we are not equipped to handle that.
There was a second part to that question. And this question, let me pose this to you, Jenny. What's the best way to handle, advise, or coach a client who keeps failing to follow their nutrition plan?
Oh, I love this question, John. We often get asked this question. So somebody who's struggling to stay on or follow their nutrition plan that you're talking with, like something that you help them set up, they're just not sticking to it. So this happens all the time, right? The road to success is not always a straight line. It curves, it goes backwards, it loop-de-loops, it does all kinds of stuff, right? It's not always a forward progress kind of thing. So one thing that I would say is first and foremost, ask questions. Ask questions, right? Somebody keeps getting hung up on something or they keep making the same quote mistake. They keep falling off the wagon in the same spot. What about that spot is causing them a hang up? Ask questions. Find out what about that situation or that issue is difficult for them. But also, I would potentially look at what I have helped them set up. Maybe the plan that we have for this person is not appropriate, or maybe it's too strict or too restrictive or doesn't fit their schedule or their budget or something. So we have to ask those questions. And then, John, I would absolutely say maybe reevaluate the way that you're going about coaching this person, whether it's the coaching advice that you're giving them, the way that you're delivering it, or the expectations that you have set for this person, and make sure that they're appropriate for where this person is at now and what they can effectively do on a regular basis. Because the goal is compliance, of course. We want them to feel successful, meaning every day they can go to bed saying, I did all the things that I wanted to do today and I did them to the best of my ability. But if we don't do that, think of the last time you felt that way, John. You wanted to do something. I wanted to go to the gym and run 3 miles today, but either I didn't go or I went and I only got 1 mile in. I feel like I failed, right? Nobody wants to feel that sense of failure. So let's maybe set something up that you can succeed in, and then we'll progressively make it more challenging or bigger as we go. What would you say for that part?
Yeah, I don't have much to add other than just kind of reframing what you said. You know, the question is, what's the best way to handle, advise, or coach a client who keeps failing to follow their nutrition plan? Well, there's two main things we can look at. It's either the client or it's the plan, kind of like what you said. So we have to try to figure that out first. And if it's the client, then like you said, we start asking questions. What's holding you back? What are the barriers that are holding you back from following this plan? That might actually lead you to figure out that it is the plan, because here's the thing. When people work with us or work with professionals, if we help design something for them and we say something like, hey, so does this look doable? You think you can do this to help you move towards your goals? A lot of them are just going to say yes. They're going to say, yeah, it looks great, because they haven't tried it yet.
Yeah.
And then when they try it, they realize it's not as doable as they thought. This is where asking questions like, how is the meal planning going? How is that going? And if they say, yeah, I'm having trouble with this, this, and this, then as coach, it's time to jump in and help, because there might be something about the plan that, although on paper looks like a good plan in application, it's not working. So again, if it's not working, it's either the person or the plan, maybe a combination of both, but address it sooner than later so that you can adjust it based on, now that they've tried it and they realized the original plan wasn't working the way that they wanted it to, now you can make adjustments based on, now they've tried it, let's now make the changes knowing what we know now based on what we originally set up.
I love it. So hopefully that's helpful for you guys, because you will, I promise you will, run into clients who don't follow the plan. It is what it is. It's going to happen. So figuring out your best way or your most effective way of approaching it. And John makes a great point. Focus on those two things. It's either the client, right? There's something in them. Maybe they're not in the right stage of change or something, or it's the plan. The plan is not appropriate for them. We have to figure out which one's which, or maybe it's both. Okay. All right. Next question here, John. There's a question that said, how can I get youth more interested in nutrition, and where can they utilize the information I'm giving them? What would you say for this one, working with youth?
So some of this is the same as getting youth interested in fitness, right? And finding some way to make it meaningful to them is the obstacle. You know, it sounds like an easy enough answer, but you know, in practice, I'm sure it's challenging. But trying to find ways to make nutrition meaningful can be great. Now, this kind of depends on the age, because attaching meaning to something also means that you have to have some sort of logical reasoning. And if you're five,
yeah,
if there's a cake in front of me, there's no logic. If I've had cake before and I'm a kid and I see cake, there's no logic that's getting in my way. I want that cake, right? So we can't have expectation of like logical reasoning of kids that age. Now, this is kind of a side note and maybe something for you all to research on your own. But as I understand it, a lot of kids' tastes or people's tastes are formulated within those first 5 years of life. This is something I've read over and over again, but you can certainly research it for yourself. And again, if you've been exposed to hyper palatable foods, foods that have that very scientific, incredible mix of salt, sugar, fat, all that good stuff, then their brain doesn't know any different. They just know, when I eat that thing, it is great and I want more of it. So there is, I think, you know, something to be said for maybe holding out on that stuff until the kid gets a little bit older. I've had friends who have done this with their kids. And, you know, it's shocking to me when I see like a 7-year-old request more vegetables at the dinner table, but I've seen it because some of my friends did it because they kind of held out on kind of the sweets and cakes and things like that until they started having some social gatherings, birthday parties and things like that, where they were exposed to it.
Yeah, I would agree with that one, John. And somebody, as somebody who works with kids a lot too, I would also caution you, if you work with children, why are you trying to coach children on their nutrition, right? Because the general guidance with kids and food is most kids, right? Food availability is big, but most kids will stop eating when they're hungry. They'll seek out food when they're hungry or when they're full. They'll seek out food when they're hungry. Most kids make generally good choices, but the choices that kids make in their nutrition, John, are controlled by who, generally speaking?
The parents.
The parents or their guardians, right? It may not be their parents, but whoever's taking care of them and giving them food. So keep in mind, that could be a guardian or a parent. It could be a school or a daycare or a caretaker or nanny, right? That's the person that I would go after as far as helping this kid make better choices. They're the people who do the shopping or give the kid food. So those are the people that I would probably go after first, because the general recommendation with kids is kind of let kids be kids and let them kind of feel their way through it. Because what we don't want to do is make them like hyper aware of their nutritional choices too early, to where, like John says, there's no rational thought behind it. And then they just become obsessed with good things, bad things, the way we assign that to things. Or I can't have carbs because my mom said I shouldn't have carbs. Well, just because your mom doesn't eat carbs doesn't mean that's appropriate for the kid. Does that make sense, you guys? So I would be very, very cautious about coaching kids more than, hey, we're going to go play a soccer game. Let's make sure that we have orange slices. Do we understand why we eat orange slices? They're yummy and they give us energy, right? Like, keep it fun, keep it light, keep it general. It doesn't need to be super, super specific when it comes to kids. But I would absolutely engage with the people who provide them their food, whether it's coaches, schools, daycares, nannies, guardians, etc. That's who I would go after. Anything you want to add on that one, John?
No, you know, I think you kind of nailed it. And, you know, everything we said, none of it, I'll preface all of it by saying that none of it is expected to be easy. Cause I've coached kids before. I've done like fitness class with kids before. And sometimes just getting their attention is a whole ton of work. So adding into that, getting them to make different choices with the way that they eat, that can be a lot. I would say that a lot of that would fall on the education of the parents. A lot of parents, I mean, if they don't know much about nutrition, then, you know, that's kind of the information that's going to be handed down.
Absolutely.
All right. Next question, Jenny. Are materials provided once we obtain our certification to help us market ourselves? And are there any infographics or nutrition-based digital assets available?
I love this question. So take this with a grain of salt. I'm not saying you got to do it yourself, but you kind of need to do it yourself, you guys. As far as to help you market yourself, there's a million ways that you can go around nutrition coaching, and there's a ton of different clientele that you could potentially go and coach. So no, the short answer is no. ISSA does not provide you guys with stuff to help market yourselves. We give you advice on how to market yourself, where to market yourself, the ways that you can market yourself. But what you create, make that your own. Put your own little stamp, your own little personality on it. And it should be based on who it is that you're coaching and how, right? Your specific business should be involved with that. So it's not something that we can really provide you, because we don't want to put you guys in a box. We want you to go out there and explore and figure out how you want to do this. And as far as infographics and nutrition, things like that to share with clients, 1000% that kind of stuff is available. And I'm going to say this, and if you've ever been to a boot camp with me and John, you're going to be like, oh, I totally knew this. Look at the nutrition guidelines. In the US, it's My Plate, right? Eat Right or Eat Well in the UK, right? Search nutrition guidelines in insert country online. It'll come up with the whatever resource for the governmental organization that creates and manages the dietary or nutrition guidelines for that area. And we've told you before, you guys, there are so many resources, posters, flyers, handouts, color graphics, all kinds of things that you guys can use for free that are part of those guidelines, and those governmental organizations release that for you guys. So again, go to a search engine online, search nutritional guidelines in insert country, and it will come up. I promise you it will come up. Follow the rabbit hole and you will find a ton of infographics and resources that you can use. No need to recreate the wheel there. There's literally a government funded organization that does it for you. Okay. And then of course you can modify or adjust whatever you need to. Would you say anything else or add anything there, John?
Just in general, just learn a thing or two about marketing and some of the different types of marketing that are out there, because some of them may speak to you a little bit more, or may feel more user-friendly or easier to do than others. But just have some general knowledge on how to market yourself and some of the easiest ways. I think social media is a very easy way to market yourself, especially if you have friends or followers on there. Those are people that you can start marketing to right away, not just for their business, but for them to kind of share that you have a business going on. So again, that's an easy, not very costly way to market yourself. So just kind of familiarize yourself with the different ways to get your message out there.
Love it. All right, John, there was another question. What is the best type of protein supplement for people whose stomachs are sensitive to protein powders?
Well, first we have to figure out what exactly you're sensitive to, because mm-hmm. There are different types of protein powders. If you take a whey-based protein, that's a dairy product there, you may have a lactose issue when it comes to that sort of protein powder. There are plant-based protein powders, and maybe there are some plants that you are allergic to and others that you are not. So for the question where it says, what's the best type of protein powder for sensitive stomachs? It's the type that you're not sensitive to, which is a very blanket answer. But again, there's many different types of protein supplements. So we would have to figure out, why are you sensitive? What are you sensitive to? And then are there other protein sources that you are not sensitive to?
Yeah, I agree, John. And I know you always like to say it this way too. When somebody asks what the best type of something is, remember guys, the word best is relative. Best meaning what? And the first question John asks can help you start to figure out what that means. Is there something that you're trying to get out of this product or something you are trying to avoid, right? Give me details. What are you looking for out of this product? And then we can find one or multiple brands or types that give you what you're looking for or trying to avoid. Does that make sense? We have to know what it is that you're looking for or trying to avoid before we can tell you what the best one is. And you also might try that and it doesn't work for you. So does that make it the best? Maybe, maybe not. So it depends is the biggest answer there. It depends. But don't be afraid to try stuff. I always recommend when it comes to shopping, not only for you guys, but when you recommend or when you're talking, we don't recommend supplements, right? When we're talking to clients about supplements, John asked me about a protein powder. I'm going to tell John, if you're interested in trying some things, let's figure out what it is that you're looking for out of this. And here are some places you can go to purchase it, because I am big on A, they have good pricing. Based on what I know, find some places that, whether it's Amazon, the local Sprouts, your Whole Foods, whatever, where do you know that you've seen these things before where the price is relatively good, okay, which might require some legwork on our end to understand what these things go for. But also, I would tell John to go somewhere that has a pretty darn good return policy so that if you don't like it, you can take it back and not have any issues returning it. And I would make that very clear. Hey, John, the Sprouts down the street from us here has quite a variety of proteins that fit what you're looking for. I definitely recommend going and checking there, and they have a great return policy too. So even if you open the package, if you decide you don't like it, you can bring it back and get your money back. Right? That's practical right there. Completely practical. Cool.
That's some solid advice, by the way. I think I've just been the person that would just throw away something if it wasn't working out for me, but that's some solid advice.
See, and a lot of these places, John, will take stuff back. You'd be surprised, but most people don't ask, or that's how those, you know, money back guarantees always work, because most people don't take things back because think about it. It's kind of a human thing. We don't want to admit that we were wrong or that something didn't work for us. So most people, when you give them the option to return something, they won't because they feel like they failed. That's not it at all. It didn't work for you. So go get your money back and try something else.
All right. Next question. Another kind of parenting question. How can you help a parent who is having trouble keeping their child from overeating while at school?
Ooh, good one. I love that we're getting all these parenting ones, John, because neither of us are parents. However, yeah. we both work with and have worked with kids before. Mm-hmm. Okay. A parent who's having a trouble with their child overeating at school. So I have questions, right? I have additional questions. So like, are you sending your kid to school with food? And where are they getting this other food? If they're eating more than what you're giving them or what they should be consuming, where are they getting it from? Would be my question, right? Are they, you know, eating somebody else's lunch? Are they getting it from a teacher's room? Like I've had teachers before, John, like especially in elementary school, they had like candy in their drawers. And I'm not gonna lie, I got caught stealing candy a couple times because I knew where it was. And I'd go in at recess and like dig through their drawers, and then they'd come in and be like, what are you doing in here? Guilty as charged. But yeah, my question would be, where are you getting it from? And then I would address those, have the parent anyway, because it's their responsibility, have the like let the parent know, like you should probably address those things in that school. Does that make sense, right? Because if I don't know where your food, this food is coming from, I can't really tell you how to make your kid stop eating it. But also, what does your kid have to eat in the first place? And, you know, is there a reason that they're seeking out additional food? Are they hungry still? Or do they not like what you're sending? I have a lot of questions. What about you, John?
Same. I have questions. I mean, some of it has to do with the availability, which was kind of what you were alluding to. Is there just a bunch of food available? And again, when you're a kid, if it's available, there's a difference between hunger and appetite. Like hunger is your physiological need for some nutrients. Appetite is things are delicious and I want that. That's a more psychological thing, right? And again, when you're a kid, I remember even through my teens, I wasn't really being logical about food. I just, if it was available, I'd eat it. So in much the same way, if it's available, I think a lot of these kids are going to make the choice to eat it unless instructed otherwise, or we just take away that availability. So again, this might be a little outside of what me and Jenny normally do, but I will say that with adults, I've had to do kind of the same thing, right? Let's just make some of these snacks that you're snacking on while you're at home not available at home anymore. Because sometimes availability is the thing that makes or breaks people's adherence to their own nutrition plan.
Yeah, that's a fair statement. All right, John, we got one more question from last week. It says, what is the best way to address the information that your client is looking for that is out of scope of your expertise? So this kind of goes along with what you were just saying. Like when you need to refer them to a dietitian or a sports medicine doctor because their symptoms or complaints could be potentially a medical issue. What say you?
This is where the medical clearance from a doctor comes in the first place. You can just, again, be direct with them and just let them know, hey, I feel a little unsure about some of the symptoms or some of the things that you told me you've got going on. Let's just get that doctor's clearance to make sure that we're good to go. And then if their doctor does not clear them, it's the doctor that's going to say, hey, I need you to go to a physical therapist. Or it's the doctor that's going to say, hey, I need you to go see this clinical dietitian or whatever the case may be. And now it'll be coming from the doctor and it'll be just simply up to you to make sure that you're kind of reinforcing it. So we don't have to be the person that tells them exactly where to go to address their needs, but you can tell them that, especially if you don't have medical clearance for them from their doctor, you can at least ask for that. And if the doctor says they're good to go, then you're probably good to go. But if the doctor finds something else, then they will make the recommendation for their client to go see a specialist.
Yeah, I agree. We have to get more comfortable, normalize telling people you don't know, okay? Or this is more than what I'm prepared to help you with, right? And again, like I said earlier, you guys, a lot of people are like, well, where do I send this person for this specific issue? Start with their physician. Just send them back to their regular doctor. And doctors make referrals all the time. So they're like, oh, I can't help you with this. Let's get you to insert specific specialist here. And they'll refer them to somebody else too. Okay, so start with the physician. That's a great place to start. And then they'll refer them to where they need to go. But it's okay to say, I can't help you with this, but I'd love for you to get help so we can help you move forward. All right. John, any last words as we wrap up our very first Office Hours After Hours?
You know, I like adding more time where we get to address all of our students' questions. So I'm hoping that we can kind of grow this. We've been on kind of a hot streak of getting all these questions, but hopefully we can get some more and keep this thing going, because I think we just covered just in a, I don't know how long we've been going, 20 minutes or so. We covered some pretty relevant things. And again, we're not going to know that you want to hear about this or talk about this unless you ask.
Absolutely. The only bad question is the one that you don't ask, you guys. So keep those questions rolling in. Thank you for joining us for our Office Hours After Hours. And hey, we'll see you guys in boot camp. Have a good one, guys.
Bye, everybody.